Good morning and welcome to the third meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our committee convener, Neil Gray, was appointed as Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development on Tuesday and has therefore resigned from his convenership of this committee. We wish Neil all the best in his new post and thank him for all the work he's done for the committee. As Deputy Convener, I welcome Alina Whittam MSP to the committee. Alina will replace Neil as a committee member. Apologies have also been received by a Marodic MSP, and we welcome Evelyn Tweed MSP back to the committee as her substitute. Before we turn to the appointment of our new convener, I invite Alina Whittam to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you and good morning to colleagues and committee and witnesses. Just to let everybody know that I need to declare that I'm still a councillor in East Ayrshire Council. Thank you.
Thank you, Alina. We now move to the appointment of our new convener. On the 15th of June 2021, the Parliament agreed by motion that members of the Scottish National Party are eligible to be chosen as convener of the committee. I nominate Alina Whittam to be our convener. Are we agreed? Yes, perfect. Congratulations, Alina. I will now pass over to you to chair the remainder of this morning's meeting.
Thank you very much for that, Natalie. I'm looking forward very much to working with the committee. This morning, we are going to be considering three items of subordinate legislation as outlined on the committee's agenda. The Minister will begin by making a joint opening statement on the Adult Disability Payment Regulations and the related information sharing amended regulations before we consider each motion in turn. We will then consider the remaining negative SSI on today's agenda. The committee has undertaken some work in advance of these regulations being laid. The committee took evidence from the Scottish Fiscal Commission on the 7th of October and heard from some stakeholders at our meeting on the 16th of December. The committee also wrote to the minister following these sessions to seek further information in advance of today's discussion. And the committee wrote to the Cabinet Secretary after our session on the budget on the 13th of January. This letter also included some questions on ADP. We look forward to our discussion this morning on these very important regulations. So I welcome to the meeting Ben McPherson MSP, Minister for Social Security and Local Government. The Minister is joined by Scottish Government officials. Today we have Kayleigh Blair and Camillo Arredondo, both solicitors for the Scottish Government. We have David Hilbert, who is team leader on case transfer policy, and Nathan Gill, team leader of disability benefits policy. And from Social Security Scotland, we have Janet Richardson, Deputy Director of Client Services Delivery. And just now, I would like to invite the Minister to make an opening statement. Over to yourself, Minister. Thank you.
Good morning, Convener and members, and welcome to the committee and congratulations on your new role. Thank you all for inviting me to give evidence today on these important regulations, which, if passed, will introduce adult disability payment in Scotland. Adult disability payment will be the 12th benefit to be administered by Social Security Scotland, and it is the biggest and most complex undertaking for the organisation to date. I strongly believe that these regulations deliver on the principles of the Social Security Scotland Act 2018 and the Scottish Social Security Charter. This is in large part due to the extensive input of a range of organisations and individual disabled people across the country. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of those whose contributions have helped shape adult disability payment. I'm also immensely grateful to the members of the Scottish Commission on Social Security, SCOS, who have given their time generously and engaged openly with myself and officials. SCOS have made a number of insightful recommendations on the regulations, almost all of which accepted. Convener, these regulations will enable us, the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland, to commence the delivery of adult disability payment for new applicants from the 21st of March, initially in Perthshire and Kinross, Dundee and the Western Isles. We will then introduce adult disability payment across two further pilot phases before rolling it out nationally on the 29th of August. Critically, the passage of these regulations will enable us to take a very different approach to delivering disability assistance, developed around our principles, dignity fairness and respect. We will put an end to the stress and anxiety of private sector assessments. There will be no undignified physical and mental examinations. We will end the stressful cycle of unnecessary reassessments and the adversarial approach of the DWP. In contrast, we are introducing a system that is rooted in trust and supported by the input of suitably qualified in-house health and social care practitioners. We are funding an independent advocacy service which will support people to access social security throughout their journey. And only one piece of information from a formal source will be sought to support the general care and mobility needs in a person's application. And the onus of collecting that information will be on Social Security Scotland. Equal weight will be given to all sources of information, including from people who know the person applying best, their friends, family, and informal support network. And applications from people with a terminal illness will be fast-tracked so they can access the support they need and are entitled to as quickly as possible. Overall, the experience of applying for and receiving adult disability payment will be fundamentally different than the current DWP. Convener, I must also state that if these regulations are not passed, people will not be able to benefit from the significant improvements we intend to make. People would be left on PIP for longer, potentially subject to the indignity and anxiety of private sector assessments. So it is crucial as a parliament that we pass these regulations. Convener, we intend to begin the case transfer of PIP awards to adult disability payment when it launches nationally in August. The case transfer of approximately 300,000 disability benefit awards from the Department of Work and Pensions to Social Security Scotland is an unprecedented exercise in both its scale and complexity, and we have therefore consistently prioritised the safe and secure delivery of adult disability payment. This approach has been supported by SCOS, the Disability and Carers Benefits Expert Advisory Group, DAPBEG, and by many responses to our public consultations, disability assistance and adult disability payment. We have therefore, as I've laid out, focused on making changes that will have the greatest positive impact on how people experience accessing support, whilst not risking safe and secure delivery. This is why the rules for adult disability payment will be broadly the same during the transition period. I want to stress, though, that what will be delivered on day one will be significantly different from how people experience the DWP. But it is also not the limit of Scottish ministers' aspirations. Convener, we have already announced an independent review of adult disability payment, which will be carried out in two stages. The initial stage will commence later this year, and we will look at the mobility criteria. And then the full adult disability framework will be considered during the second stage of the review, beginning in summer 2023. In conclusion, I'm confident and determined that from day one, adult disability payment will deliver a new and much improved experience for disabled people and those with long-term health conditions. This experience will reflect the human right to social security and the ethos of dignity, fairness and respect, which is at the heart of this new system we are creating and delivering. I welcome this opportunity today to assist the committee in its consideration of the regulations, and I'm now very happy to take any questions committee members may have.
Thank you very much for that opening statement, Minister. I know that this is an area that my fellow committee members are very passionate about, and they have very many questions this morning to put to yourself. Our questions are grouped around themes. Theme one is changes to eligibility criteria and independent review. Theme two is about the transfer from PIP and DLA over to ADP. Theme three is moving from child disability payment to adult disability payment. Theme four is about gathering evidence and consultations. Theme five is about the financial impacts, and theme six is about monitoring and evaluation. So I'm going to move to committee members for their questions, and I'm going to start with Marie McNair and then over to Pam Duncan-Glance after that. So Marie, over to yourself. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and congratulations on your appointment. Good morning, Minister. Is it the case if the Westminster Government got rid of the 20-metre rule for PIP then it would create the space for a similar change in Scotland to take place for ADP.
Well, I think the important considerations around the theme of what Marie McNear is raising around why the criteria that we are bringing forward, the eligibility criteria, needs to be largely the same. And it's fundamentally, as I know the committee is aware, around three important considerations. One is safe and secure transfer. Two is making sure that we don't create a two-tier system where people on PIP who are still to transfer into Social Security Scotland would be subject to different conditions than those who are applying for ADP. And thirdly, fundamental important questions around passporting and ADP being considered on a like-for-like basis by the DWP as PIP is for passporting benefits. Now, I think it's important to point out that we have made some changes within the eligibility criteria that relate to the better experience that we want people to have. But throughout our engagement with DWP, it was important that for them that there wasn't significant changes to the eligibility criteria in order for ADP to be considered on a like-for-like basis for passporting. Now, related to the 20-metre rule, which Maria McNair raised, and I know you've received as a committee a lot of evidence of this, as have Scottish Government ministers, had a lot of engagement on this issue with stakeholders and others. It's important that people understand that if the DWP were to make a change to their eligibility rules, of course that could have an impact. One, it would mean that we would be able to be more assured that the DWP would consider ADP with different eligibility rules that were concurrent with any changes that the DWP were making for passporting issues. But also the considerations of any added payment out around the fiscal framework would also be built into the resources received by the Scottish Government in terms of having greater resources for paying Social Security. And of course, we're already committing a significant amount of additional resource in order to pay over and above what we receive from the UK Government through the fiscal for Social Security benefits, and because we want to do more and assist people more in our communities. Of course, we've had no indication from the DWP that they intend to change the 20-metre rule, and that was certainly not a suggestion in their green paper.
Thank you very much for that answer, Minister. Marie, do you have anything further?
Yes, I have two further questions, Convener. You're clear in source costs that safe and secure transfer must be the priority before major changes are considered. So the approach that any further change will be guided by the independent review. And you've indicated that the first stage of the rule will focus on the mobility criteria. What is the rationale for this? And can you say any more about the wider remit of the review?
Thank you. Of course, the independent review was announced by Shailene Somerville when she was Cabinet Secretary for Social Security. And that was a recognition of the fact that as we deliver adult disability payment, we want to receive feedback and insight as to how stakeholders believe the new system is performing, but also to think ahead as to when we move beyond the period of case transfer and all the people in receipt of disability benefits are in the Scottish Social Security system, what then can and should we change whether that be the eligibility criteria or other considerations. So, and of course, we are in this system at the moment, not just a hybrid system with the UK government, but a system where we have these two processes in tandem from the 21st of March when we launch adult disability payment. We will be accepting new applications for adult disability payment and simultaneously transferring the over 300,000 individuals who are on PIP into our system. So the review is really important, and it's important that it has that feedback from how people are experiencing the system. We plan to establish a group to undertake the review with its members and chair drawn from outside the Scottish Government, and it's intended that the group will secure input from people with experience of applying for and receiving ADP as a. I appreciate that there will be a lot of interest in the review, and I'm determined that as many people as possible will have the opportunity to contribute to the process. The review will be completely independent, as I've said, and therefore it would be wrong for me to preempt any recommendations. However, planning and scoping work is already underway on the first stage of the review, and I will provide a further update as soon as possible to the committee and Parliament. I think it's the reason we wanted the review, as I laid out in my letter to the committee on the 17th of December, to commence with consideration of the mobility criteria, is because we are very mindful of and respectful of the significant amount of evidence that the committee has received and discussion that there has been around the mobility criteria, and we want to make sure that we are getting that process of reviewing those considerations underway as quickly as we can.
Thanks very much, Minister Moody. Do you have a further question?
Yes, thanks, Convener. The changes to terminal illness criteria will make a huge difference, and the change not only you don't have to require a time limit anymore, which is fantastic, but also gives a more generous award. And PIP, as I understand it, it's a diagnosis that only automatically get the enhanced rate of daily living, where in ADP, as you know, you get enhanced rates of daily living and mobility. Is this change motivated with intentions of ensuring that those with a terminal diagnosis get a higher possible financial support at a time of greatest need?
I think Marie McNair is absolutely right to highlight these important differences. I'm mindful of time not so long ago when I was a member of the committee going through the process of the Social Security Act 2018. When it was a bill, and there was really powerful evidence provided by those organisations who support people at a time of terminal illness and their families. And I think it's a real tribute to the Parliament as a whole and the stakeholders that we work with that we have got to this point of delivering that support for those with a terminal illness. And of course, it's important that there's an appropriate adequacy of support, but also that people get that support quickly. And that's exactly why we have taken the position where we will rely on the evidence of clinicians in order to make our decisions around granting those with a terminal illness that support, so that it's not a consideration around time periods, it's a consideration around people's situation and the medical position. And that will enable people to get that support as quickly as possible.
Thank you very thank you very much, Marie, for your questions, and thank you to the Minister for his responses. I'll now move on to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy, and then after that we will bring Jeremy Balfour in for his questions. Over to yourself, Pam. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Convener, and congratulations on your appointment to the committee and as Chair. And can I also put on record my thanks to Neil Gray, who was an excellent chair of the committee and who we will miss, and wish him well in his new role. I also want to say thank you to the Minister and his officials for coming here today with the regulations. The current system of support for disabled people is wholly inadequate, and I recognise and congratulate the Government for the work that they have done to make the improvements that they have. However, it will come as no surprise to the Minister, officials or other members of the committee that I believe that we are considering regulations today that are a serious missed opportunity. In the midst of a cost of living crisis, when 31% of disabled people are living in poverty, we could have been looking at addressing things like eligibility and adequacy of these payments. But instead, we're looking very much only at process. Now, I recognise that some of the changes in that process will, of course, improve it, but the bar was very low. And so I have to say I am underwhelmed by what we see in front of us today. Let me start just by picking up the point about the 20 metre rule, if that's all right, Minister. The Minister set out that the UK Government haven't yet indicated their intent to get rid of the 20-metre rule, but I note that neither has the Scottish Government nor the Minister, despite the fact I've asked a direct question several times about your intention, about their intention around the 20-metre rule. So could the Minister set out today whether or not it is the Government's intention to get rid of the 20-metre rule?
Can you hear?
Yes, over to you, Minister.
Thank you. So, first of all, thank you to Pam Duncan-Glancy for her engagement and also for her recognition of the significant changes that are being made. On the points raised around the fact that we have been constrained in our process of how much we can consider the eligibility criteria for change and consider adequacy for change, I would just refer to my points in my opening statement about the fact that in this current situation where we have these two work streams in tandem of launching new benefit for applications and undertaking the case transfer, significant case transfer, unprecedented in its complexity, we have to make sure that we are providing a situation where those who are receiving the new benefit of adult disability payment and those who are being transferred under the case transfer process from August receive the same amounts and are subject to the same criteria for assessment. That's about equality and parity and making sure that while we're in this two tandem work stream, that we're treating people the same and not having a two-tier system. I talked about the review earlier, and I think that's an important point that I would just like to emphasise again, that we recognise that once case transfer has been complete, we should, as a society, as a parliament, together, consider what changes we should make at that juncture, and what people's experience has been of adult disability payment. So, we will receive through the process of that review, once there has been experience of the new system, what people's perceptions and experience has been through that process. And we appreciate that we have heard time and time again over recent years that the PIP descriptors are not consistently applied to individuals, particularly with mental health conditions, fluctuating conditions, for learning disabilities, and that has been indicative in the fact that numerous successful appeals to the DWP show that the PIP criteria have been wrongly interpreted. For example, when an individual is asked whether they can complete an activity either at application stage or during a consultation, the PIP criteria and the way the DWP has, through an assessment rather, DWP have considered those issues has not been properly applied and consistently considered. However, in our system, when an individual is asked whether they can complete an activity either at an application stage or during a consultation with Social Security Scotland with a practitioner from Social Security Scotland, the full impact and activity on the individual, including pain and fatigue, will be considered. So we will be applying the reliability criteria properly and consistently. And if someone tells us they cannot walk a certain distance without losing balance, it will mean that they cannot walk that distance safely. The changes we are making to the delivery of adult disability payments, such as providing additional application channels and replacing assessments and person-centred consultations, are intended to address many of the concerns that people rightly have around how mobility criteria are applied. We will monitor the impacts of these changes on awards and collect feedback from clients and stakeholders, as I've said, and also we cannot know for certain what those impacts of the improvements that we're making will be until we commence delivery, and that is why it's important that we have the pilot and the review. And so, of course, the Scottish Fiscal Commission have also projected that we will spend more on adult disability payment because of the way we're delivering it. So that's an indication from them about the fact that they believe that more people will be successful in obtaining awards. So now is not the time to be definitive on particular parts of the eligibility criteria and whether they should change once we've undertaken the review. So undertake the review, let's see what people's experiences of the new system, and then together we can consider what the recommendations are of the review and what change we could or should make once we merge past the process of this twin set of work streams that we're going to be in very shortly of delivering the new benefit and delivering case transfer at the same time.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. And I can see from the chat that Evelyn Tweed would like to come in. Is it on this point, Evelyn?
Sorry, convener.
Is it on this point you want to come in before I hand back to Pam?
Yes, it is, convener.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Thank you. Good morning, Minister. Can you outline for the committee how the Scottish Commission on Social Security felt about how the Scottish Government was dealing with eligibility, and what was their view on the approach that the Scottish Government had taken? Thank you.
Thank you, Evelyn. Thank you. Yourself, Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and to Evelyn Tweed. I think it's an important point to raise, because I know both in committee's evidence on the 16th of December and from correspondence that I've sent the committee, that the committee will be aware that SCOS support the position that we've taken, and they have, after significant engagement with the Scottish Government and thorough consideration of the issues, and that was really important engagement that we had with SCOS, and we were very grateful for it. They endorsed our overriding commitment to safe and secure transfer, stating that they are persuaded that changing eligibility criteria at this time would risk undermining the delivery of adult disability payment with extremely detrimental consequences for people who depend on it. And I'm also mindful, of course, as well, that Dark Beak have stated that in the short term, we agree that no significant changes should be made to eligibility rules to ensure a safe and secure transition. So we have engaged with those that you would expect on this really important issue, and we are both reassured, comforted and grateful that they share a position. And of course, collectively, we want to, in time, not just in the short term through the delivery of ADP and all the significant improvements that we made that I laid out earlier in the session, but also in the years thereafter, once case transfer has been undertaken, we all want to improve the situation as much as we can for disabled people. And I think it's important that we undertake the process in the years ahead of case transfer and launch in the way that is envisaged in these regulations, to make sure that we both deliver adult disability payment better than PIP is delivered in terms of experience and approach, which I've laid out, and the important changes that we're making, and then that we consider after safe and secure transfer where we go next with the benefit. I also should state that I think the changes that we're making, particularly around the reliability criteria, will make a significant, applying the reliability criteria properly will make a significant difference for people, and the experience of adult disability payment will be much improved, just like the feedback on child disability payment to the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland has been very positive in terms of people's experience of it being a very different system and approach to that which they've experienced previously in the DWP.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. I'm going to hand back to Pam Duncan-Glancy for her to continue. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the points you raised as a result of my question, Minister. I'm not sure, though, that you did set out whether or not it was your intention to get rid of the 20-metre rule. So perhaps you could address that in your closing remarks. I also noted your point around it not being the time to do this, and I can't help but say we were also told that in 2018 when disabled people were keen to put the sort of thing that they wanted, the ambition they wanted, on the face of the bill, as were the Scottish Labour Party, and we were told in 2018 to trust that this would be sorted in regs. Here we are in 2022, and still eligibility criteria and adequacy of the payments aren't going to be addressed again until the payments under that new system will be after the review, and looking like that will be at least 2025. So it seems for disabled people, who, again, I'll say 31% of whom are living in poverty across this country, are being told now is not the time. So hopefully the time will be soon. And I ask the government, I ask the minister to set out when is the time. I have other specific questions, if it's okay, and I'll move on. On the descriptors, thank you for your reassurance about the way that they'll be applied, the minister's reassurance the way they'll be applied. And I'm confident, actually, that some of the work that's gone into training through Social Security Scotland may indeed bear that out, and we'll look forward to seeing that and scrutinising that further. But can you can the minister set out whether you've considered what a system that is not functional disability, a functional system that looks at a points-based system, have you considered what else you could do to address this and when? Also, is the minister able to more explicitly reference psychological distress and how that will be applied in the descriptors and in the assessment process? We've also heard from many, many people who have given evidence to the committee that there's not enough in the regulations about being able to make a journey safely. And so this can make things really difficult for people who have mental health issues, particularly to get the enhanced rate. How does the government plan to address that? And related to that, changing and variable conditions is something that a number of organisations and people have told us are not significantly addressed in the regulation. So what could the minister do to set out on the record how these concerns will be addressed in the regulations or in future guidance? Could the minister also set out, I appreciate there's a lot of questions here, but I realise that I have the talking stick for a limited period. Can the minister also set out how he sees the relationship and possible divergence between case law in the UK and Scotland as the payments are rolled out, and what would happen, for example, when a change in UK case law would mean that the UK system became more generous than its counterpart here? And finally, will there be any explicit reference in guidance to how the new system will support people with mental ill health through the application process, and can the minister set out what that support would look like? Thank you.
Many thanks for your questions. Pam, over to yourself, Minister.
Thank you, Convener. I'll try to come back on as many of those as possible, but forgive me, Pam Duncan-Glancy, if you do come back on some of those, just given the extent of the list of the questions provided. So, firstly, I in terms of considerations around the 20-metre rule, as I said, we need to consider this within the process of the review. We need to get the feedback of how adult disability payment is performing once we've commenced launch, and then we need to undertake the independent review in order for the government to receive feedback on the eligibility criteria. And of course, we are undertaking consideration of the mobility criteria in 2022. As I set out in a previous answer. In terms of the considerations around the points that have been raised with the committee with regard to those with fluctuating conditions and mental health, mental illness and ill health, I appreciate the evidence that the committee received on the 16th of December and considered that with interest and intent in an appropriate manner, and I'm grateful for the evidence that was provided. I would just go back to some of the key fundamental points that our new system will deliver, which is, we've removed all functional examinations from the process. So, as members will know, currently the DWP carry out examinations such as testing flexibility and strength, or the mental state examination. These tests do not meet our values of fairness, dignity and respect, and we know from feedback from individuals who've been through the process cause widespread stress and anxiety, and we don't want that in our new system. So the liability criteria, which I've mentioned previously, which require a person to be able to carry out activities safely, repeatedly, and to an acceptable standard in a reasonable time, are more fully defined in our legislation in order to help us to make sure that when an individual is asked whether they can complete an activity such as walking 20 metres, the full impact of that activity on the individual, including pain and fatigue, will be considered. And you know, when the points of consideration are there with regard to fluctuating conditions, which I really appreciate has been a point in the evidence that the committee has heard, and the improvements we are making to the delivery of ADP, such as providing additional application channels and replacing assessments with person-centred consultations, are intended to address many of the concerns people have around the eligibility criteria and how they are applied, and its impacts on people with fluctuating conditions such as MS and epilepsy. So we have proposed a new way of making entitlement decisions for adult disability payment, as I've said, to ensure that the criteria are fairly applied to all clients, to all people. And this includes stringently applying the reliability criteria, which I've just pointed out what that involves, and the fact, as I've said, that these criteria are more fully enshrined in the regulations and embedded in every step of the decision-making process, which means that decisions will take full account of fluctuating conditions. As I've said earlier today as well, the application process will be inclusive, accessible, and provided in a range of formats through a range of routes, that's online, phone, posted in person, and will be transparent throughout the process to help in the individual's journey. And this will also include comprehensive guidance to clients on how the eligibility criteria is applied, so they know the process as well. And of course, it will ensure a client is supported in providing relevant information guided by the reliability criteria about how they feel after completing an activity and how long that those impacts last for. And throughout the process, of course, we will have the advocacy service as well. I'm just going to bring in Janet Richardson with regard to the agency's perspective on support for clients with mental health problems. We'd be grateful, Janet, if you could elaborate on some of what I've said for the benefit of Pam Duncan Clancy and the rest of the committee.
Thanks, Minister. Welcome, Janet.
Good morning, convener. Good morning, committee members, and thank you, Minister. So, yes, I just wanted to really pick up on the point around what support we are providing for clients with mental health to make sure that they feel supported through this process. And I think it's fair to say that from the very beginning, we've worked really closely with stakeholder groups to look at what it is that concerns clients, particularly with mental health problems, about interacting with organisations such as ours. And we've really taken that on board in terms of how we're dealing with people. We've also recruited our health and social care practitioners, many of whom are specialised in mental health issues. And the fact that we are directly recruiting those people rather than being in an agency, they are working really closely with our case managers to create that relationship and to create that interaction so that they fully understand some of the issues that clients will have in that space. Equally, our local delivery teams are working again closely in every local authority with third sector and stakeholders. So they're getting to understand some of the issues and the concerns that clients have. And again, build that trust and relationship with people so that hopefully they feel more supported and able to come to us for the advice and the support that they need. That's very much part of the training for all of our colleagues in Social Security Scotland, is around creating and building trust. And we recognise that that's something really important for people, so they understand why we need to ask them for the information, what we will do with that information, how it will be used, and create that relationship which we think is missing from the process just now. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that contribution, Janet. Minister, do you have anything further to add?
Thank you, Convener. I just also wanted to bring in Nathan Gale, as they will be able to, I think, elaborate on some of the points I made on psychological distress and safety and case law, which I hope will be helpful in answer to Pam Duncan Glancy.
Yep, that's fantastic.
Thank you, Nathan. Thank you. Good morning, Convener and members. I think Ms Duncan Clancy raised an important point around the ability to do activities safely, and evidence that's previously been raised to the committee around people safely completing journeys. And I think it's important to note that in our regulations we have more fully defined safety to take into account developed case law. And that is intended to ensure that our case managers understand clearly how that criteria is supposed to be applied. We've done a great deal of work with welfare rights advisors and other expert stakeholders to make sure that developments in case law that have happened in relation to PIP are fully incorporated into our regulations. We know there can sometimes be a lag between case law coming in and the PIP legislation being amended to reflect that. So we've really made sure that the case law is embedded within our regulations from the outset. In relation to psychological distress, and that particularly relates to people with mental health conditions and their ability to mobilise and move around outside. We are aware that this is an issue that stakeholders have raised, and they do have some concerns around how those criteria may be applied. And just to build on what the Minister has said previously, those are again examples where the seeing how the criteria are applied and making sure that they accurately reflect how the client experiences their life will be really instructive as we go forward into the review. And if there are concerns around, particularly around psychological distress and how that's handled in adult disability payment, and again, that will be something that we'll be able to get raised during the review by stakeholders. So it's definitely something that we're aware of, and we're very keen to see how that develops as ADP is launched. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Nathan. Minister, did you have anything further to add, or are we able to move on?
Nothing further for me. I hope what myself and officials have been able to provide is has covered the points that Ms Duncan Glancy wished us to.
Thanks very much. Now I'm going to hand the talking stick over to Jeremy Balfour next, but Pam Duncan Glancy, I'm going to hand it back to you when we go into the next theme. So over to yourself, Jeremy. Thanks.
Good morning, Camilla, and can I add my congratulations on your appointment, and I look forward to working with you, and also to wish Neil all the best in his new role in Scottish Government. Convener, I have about four or five questions to ask the Minister, but perhaps I can just take them one at a time so we don't get lost in them, if that's okay with you. The first question is just to thank you. The first question is really to develop that final point just made in regard to case law. And that is, what happens, what is the Scottish Government thinking in regard to case law that happens once ADP is up and running? So if there is a case decided in a tribunal in Newcastle, which would be affect someone's mobility, will that automatically be applied to Scottish case law, or how will it be implemented, and who makes that decision?
Thanks very much for your question, Jeremy. Over to yourself, Minister.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. The considerations around the application of case law, of course, and as new case law emerges, and the repercussions of that in terms of what it means for the delivery of all of our benefits, which are related to the particular case law, is something that we undertake consideration of, as you would expect, on a regular and consistent basis. At this juncture, I'll bring in Kayleigh Blair in a moment from the Scottish Government Legal Division, but just to say that, of course, we are absolutely committed to considering case law as it emerges in different parts of the UK and what repercussions that has for our system and people in Scotland. Kayleigh, I'd be grateful if you could just speak briefly on this matter.
Thanks, Minister. Over to you, Kayleigh. Good morning.
Thank you, Minister, and good morning, convener and members. Thank the member for their question. And it is correct, as the Minister has said, that as case law emerges, consideration will be given in individual instances to how that should be taken on board and perhaps implemented further within the adult disability payment regulations. As the members will be aware, once adult disability payment is a benefit separate for clients within Scotland, that does limit the reach for UK level case law with regards to personal independence payment and the obligations as far as making changes in line with personal independence payments. So it can be that a determination is made as to whether the developments in UK level case law would be beneficial and should be carried forward within adult disability payment as well. So the ability for us to determine whether or not we should follow the same approach as UK level case law for personal independence payments will be broader in the sense that we'll be able to make the decision as to whether it should be followed within our benefit here in Scotland with adult disability payment. And of course, separately, we will be seeing case law in Scotland around adult disability payment itself develop, which will, of course, go on to impact the criteria and how it is applied in practice in relation to adult disability payment. Thank you.
Can I thank Ms. Blair for that answer? Can I just clarify with her then, if and some of the most key decisions around PIP and DLA previously have been made by the Supreme Court, so any decision that is made by the Supreme Court will not be binding on Scottish, if it is an English case on PIP, will not be binding on the Scottish system. But can she clarify what all decisions that have been made previously, so made up to the transfer of ADP, are they binding on decisions made now? Or are we starting with an absolute clean page?
Minister, thank do you, you want Kayleigh to come back in? Yep.
Kayleigh, I would be grateful if you could answer Mr. Balfour. Thank you.
Yes, Minister, thank you. So as my colleague Nathan mentioned, the regulations have been developed with all of the case law that has been in place so far in relation to personal independence payments in mind. And so many expansions have been made on the face of the regulations to ensure consistency with the case law that has developed in relation to personal independence payments. And examples of that can be seen, as we've discussed already, in relation to the reliability criteria being expanded, such as in the definitions of safely and to an acceptable standard. So the case law that is currently in existence is being carried forward so that it will be applied in practice in relation to adult disability payment. And the reason that we have made that on the face of the legislation is because Had we not, then moving into adult disability payment, those aspects wouldn't be binding in the same way within the Scottish system. So by pulling them into the legislation that way, we've ensured that consistency on those points.
Thank you for that. If I can move on. Minister, the reason you say one of the reasons we can't change the criteria is because of passport benefits that might be affected by that. I wonder, can you clarify, how many meetings have you had with the UK government and DWP to discuss whether that is the case and what line the DWP are taking on it? What individual discussions have you had with Westminster cabinet ministers or ministers?
Over to yourself, Minister.
So the considerations around passporting and ADB being treated on a like-for-like basis as PIP with UK government took place before my appointment. So I can say that the discussions that I've had, the three meetings that I've had with UK ministers since my appointment, have focused on where we go forward and other aspects of the social security system, but also considerations around the UK government's green paper and what that will mean for delivery of disability benefits in Scotland and the interaction between the two systems. So the engagement that took place with both ministers and officials in terms of considerations around passporting were in the last parliament. And you know, I think it's important to just emphasise that throughout those discussions, the DWP have consistently made clear, and throughout numerous discussions over that period, that passporting is subject to delivery of such a like-for-like system at this time. So that was the clear position of DWP through that period. I should say as well that the changes that we have made to eligibility criteria, which both my officials and I spoke about earlier, in terms of, for example, the reliability criteria being more fully defined in our legislation, for us to achieve that within the regulations before us today required significant engagement with DWP. There has been engagement. We're in this process of a hybrid system and the need to deliver new benefits, but also undertake case transfer. Based on the feedback from stakeholders, prioritised safe and secure delivery, and also because we think it's the right thing to do. And part of safe and secure delivery is making sure that passported benefits are secured in the process, and that adult disability payment is treated on a like-for-like basis to as PIP in a similar way by the DWP for passporting.
So just to clarify, you've not had any direct discussions with the UK government in the last 10 months about changing the criteria and how that would affect passport control. That's all happened in the last parliament. You haven't discussed that at all with any UK minister in the last 9 or 10 months.
I don't want to be definitive and say that it's never come up, but it certainly it wasn't a point of negotiation, because in order to deliver adult disability payments safely and securely, these discussions had to take place time prior to my appointment. Because of course the engagement around adult disability payment has been ongoing for some time. It was unfortunately delayed due to the pandemic because DWP had to reprioritise resources. We as the Scottish Government and Scotland as a whole had to deal with the situation of the pandemic. So these decisions were part of considerations, negotiations and discussions in the period past.
Thank you. The last question just from this section is, and the Minister, you were with me on that committee as we took through the legislation, and I think if you go back and look at the comments by particularly Jean Freeman when she was the Cabinet Secretary for this, there was a whole expectation that the criteria and eligibility would be very different by the time we got to this stage. And the only significant change has been around terminal illness, which interestingly was amendments brought by myself, Labour and the Greens, and that is the only significant change we've seen. What would you say this morning to someone with MS or epilepsy or another available condition who, yes, they may have a nice experience but will still be turned down because they don't meet this? Having waited 6 years for some significant change around eligibility, don't you feel we as a Scottish Parliament have let these vulnerable disabled people down?
Well, first of all, I think there has to be a recognition of the effect of the pandemic, and there has to be a recognition of the fact that we are in a hybrid system, and we are in a system at the moment where we are undertaking two really significant pieces of work, the launch of new benefits and the transfer of individuals from the DWP into our system. And I would also say that the impact of the changes we are making should be understated. We are introducing a new, simplified, compassionate system that will treat everyone with dignity, fairness and respect, and provide people with that really improved experience. And you know, the impacts of these improvements, as I've stated already, are reflected in the Scottish Fiscal Commission forecasts, in which more people will be eligible for adult disability payment than PIP. And awards are also expected to be higher than PIP as a result of the improvements we are making to the application process, decision making on entitlement and reviews. So I would say to people that the change that we're delivering is significant. It will make a difference. And what I'm looking forward to seeing and receiving is the feedback from people as they go through our new system. And then also what we can think about together, once we've undertaken the really significant challenge and important task of case transfer in the years ahead, considering what the needs are for people, and also considering together how we provide more and continue to extend and enhance our social security system in the years ahead. We're at a period now of really important introduction and delivery and transfer in order to build the strongest system, not just for the next 12 months, not just for the remainder of this parliamentary term, but in order to deliver a social security system for years and decades ahead that meets the needs of people across Scotland. And I think actually the progress has been remarkable in the 3 years since 2018. The fact that we are about to deliver our 12th benefit, 7 benefits are new. We have established a new agency. It is growing, it is delivering, it is helping people. And actually I think adult disability payment will be a significant new addition to what Social Security Scotland will deliver, and will make a difference for disabled people all across Scotland. So is there more work to do in the years ahead? Absolutely. But we should be excited about what we are delivering in the period ahead, about passing these regulations and about the difference that they will make for many, many people.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. I'm going to hand back over now to Pam Duncan-Glancy, who's going to explore some the issues in theme two. Pam, and then after Pam, it will be Marie McNair again. Thank you very much.
Thank you, convener. And whilst I echo some of the sentiment the Minister has shared with us this morning around the changes to the process, I have to say excitement is not the emotion I feel about the adult disability payment regulations in front of us today. And I'm not sure that other disabled people will either. Safe and secure transition is, of course, incredibly important. And as someone who uses personal independence payment, I understand the importance of that payment still coming in order to pay for things like motability vehicles. But had we asked disabled people in 2018 if they wanted to wait until at least 2025 for fundamental changes to who was eligible or whether the payment was adequate, I think, and also Bill Scott agrees in his evidence that he gave, that we might have had a different answer around that. So I urge again the government to pick up the pace on this. On the transfer of claimants from the Disability Living Alliance and PIP to adult disability payments, I just have a couple of questions around that. During the earlier years of the discussions around social security, opening adult disability payment was due to happen, of course, earlier, but was delayed as a result of the pandemic from summer 2021 to 2022. So organisations such as SAMH and others have said they understand the coronavirus pandemic has impacted on the original timescale, and to a degree I can see that too. However, it is getting on a bit now. So we believe there should be mitigations for those affected by the delay. The government made a welcome commitment that once adult disability payment was open to new applications, no one with an existing award would be reassessed under the UK system. SAMH have identified that they think the delay by a year on these regulations could mean at least 141,000 people in Scotland will still be on PIP or have entered the PIP system who would have otherwise perhaps been assessed through adult disability payment, and about 55,000 of those people may have a mental health problem, with a large proportion likely to have gone through a very difficult, as we've highlighted, PIP face-to-face assessment. To mitigate this, will the government prioritise transfer of people from adult disability payment from PIP who successfully made a PIP claim during the delay periods, and would you introduce a rapid review of failed PIP applications made during the delay periods and a publicity campaign to encourage people to apply, reapply?
Thanks, Pam. Over to yourself, Minister.
Thank you. Again, I'll try to come back on as many of those questions as I can, and if Pam Duncan Clancy wants to raise any others at the end of my remarks that I haven't managed to cover, obviously happy to have them reposed. So I have to challenge this question around picking up the pace, because I think it's extremely unfair on the delivery of what the agency has undertaken, and I think it lacks appreciation for the situation that we have been in with the pandemic, and also the fact that we are in this hybrid system where we have to deliver the new benefits, which require significant engagement with the DWP, but also undertake case transfer. And I appreciate the evidence that the committee has heard. I listened carefully to what Bill Scott and others said. It's somebody who, throughout my time on the committee, I have significant respect for. But I think the pace has been remarkable of what Social Security Scotland have delivered. The fact that we have a really strong agency that is performing, that has delivered well, that has delivered a new benefit in that time period that was not expected in child disability, in the Scottish Child Payment. The fact that that was created by the Scottish Government, delivered by the agency in a very short period of time, and is something that I know the Parliament really strongly supports. And of course, we are doubling from April and working towards rolling out to under 16s from the end of this year, provided we get the data from the DWP. So I just think talking the achievement of Social Security Scotland down does no good for the collective determination that I know that there is in this committee and across the Parliament for the agency to be a success. This is an agency that is delivering strongly and will deliver adult disability payment strongly as well. So yes, we can all be ambitious about how we want to do more, but actually we also need to be realistic about what can be achieved in this dual process of, well, we have to undertake case transfer as quickly as we can, but also about the fact that building a new agency and delivering a new service in the way we have is an extremely complex process of building IT infrastructure, transferring data, engagement between two governments, making sure that we adhere to all the legislative requirements, making sure that we have all the checks and balances in place, making sure that we have all the people in place. This is a significant exercise, and I actually think the reason why Social Security Scotland and the Scottish Government Directorate have been award-winning in the recent times for their achievements is because the progress that has been made in the delivery of Social Security Scotland is remarkable, and adult disability payment is a significant and key next step. I want to bring Nathan Galen in a moment to talk about the fact that the changes we are making will make a significant difference. They aren't just cosmetic. I will bring him in shortly. But I'll just touch on some of the points around case transfer, because I know that there's significant interest in this, and understandably around. Members will be aware from my letter yesterday that the case transfer process for those who will be approaching a reassessment, they will be prioritised. A PIP reassessment will be prioritised so that they are naturally case transfer into our system. But we cannot we cannot consider retrospectively because adult disability payment didn't exist when people went on. People were reassessed for PIP in months or years past. But of course, if people want to make an application to adult disability payment when it's rolled out, they will be absolutely entitled to do that. And of course, Pam Duncan-Glansley rightly asked, will there be a campaign to promote adult disability payment? We are continuously, as members know, through our benefit take-up strategy and our various initiatives, promoting people to apply for all benefits that they're entitled to, because one of the key differences in the Scottish Social Security system is that we want people to get the entitlements and the benefits that they are entitled to, and we are proactively promoting the take-up of benefits, because we believe that Social Security is a human right, that it's an investment, collective investment in ourselves and each other, and will be for the benefit of building a fairer society for everyone, and that will benefit everyone. So yes, we will continue to be proactive in encouraging people to apply. Nathan, I'd be grateful if you could come in with some points around the fact that, you know, the significant changes we're making. Thank you.
Over to you, Nathan. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. To build on what the Minister has been saying about the changes, I think it is very important to remember the significance of those for disabled people. Throughout the two consultations we've done, one on disability assistance in general and one specifically on adult disability payment, we've heard from so many disabled people who have had a negative experience in trying to apply to PIP, and from people who have just because of what they've heard about PIP have been too anxious to even try and apply. So the fundamental changes that we're making, for example, to remove assessments and replace those with person-centred consultations that won't involve humiliating examinations, that simply provide a snapshot of how that person is able to function in that one moment, those really are significant changes, and it's hoped that those changes will encourage people who have previously been too anxious to apply for PIP to consider applying for ADP. So I think it's just important when we're talking about the legislation and the changes that have been made to look at those beyond that, particularly, as I say, around our new consultation service.
Thank you, Nathan.
Yeah. Convener, if I may, I also wish to just bring David Hillibur in briefly on case transfer, in case you want to just to add over and above what I've already said that may be helpful for the committee. David.
Thanks, Minister. Over to you, David.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, members. So specifically on the prioritisation issue for the PIP to ADP transfer, what we've heard very clearly from stakeholders as we've discussed case transfer for a number of years is that one of the main things that they want is to avoid DWP face-to-face assessments. And to deliver on that commitment, which we agree is important, we have decided to prioritize for PIP to ADP case transfer those who would be subject to one of those DWP face-to-face assessments after ADP launches nationally. So that's the prioritization that we've decided. Someone who reports a change of circumstance to the DWP, their case will be selected for transfer. Somebody whose fixed-term award is about to end and they would have to make an advance claim to PIP to continue, they are going to be selected for transfer. And those who are scheduled to have a review of their PIP award that would likely require a face-to-face assessment, those are the people that are going to be prioritized for transfer. So we feel that this is a really good and we have really strong reasons for deciding to transfer cases, prioritize cases for transfer in this way to avoid that very what stakeholders have told us can be a very, very stressful assessment with the DWP, and And I think, yeah, that's why we've decided to prioritise in that way.
Thank you very much for that, David. Minister, anything further to add before I hand back to Pam to see if she has further questions?
Nothing further. I just hope we've answered most of the questions that Pam Duncan-Glancy put to me.
Thank you. Pam, do you have anything further to ask at the moment?
I do. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, for your answer and to the officials for theirs. I am particularly reassured, actually, by the answer around the prioritisation of reviews or people who whose circumstances change. That's helpful to have that on the record, and I thank you for doing so. I do have a final question, but before I turn to that, I would just like to raise the point about talking down the work of the agency and the people who work in it. That is not how I characterise the problem here. The issue that we have, I think, is that the Minister and his government have promised since 2017 that there would be a significant divergence within the PIP regulations to adult disability payment regulations. That's a significant number of years ago, and we do not see a significant difference between the PIP regulations and the adult disability payment regulations. It is that delay that I have that I take issue with and that others take issue with, and it is the government's direction of that and not the delivery of the agency or the staff working hard, in particular during a pandemic, to deliver what they have done. The final question I have on the transfer from DLA to PIP is around the fact that the regulations don't yet have anything in them about the transfer for people who are on DLA to adult disability payment, rather not PIP, sorry. And I wonder if the Minister can set out why those are not in the regulations at the minute, and what I think SCOS note that they're forthcoming. So it's just to ask the Minister if there are any timescales that he has available to him that he can set out today. Thank you.
Minister.
Thank you. And of course, the undertaking of case transfer and all of these complexities are one of the main reasons why we have to be considerate of making sure we don't create a two-tier system and making sure that that transfer is secure. I think Pam Duncan-Glancy raises really important points around the transfer between DLA to ADP, and I know that this was the committee received evidence on this as part of their consideration. So, whilst it is not part of the regulations we're discussing today, I can assure the committee that I will be updating them on this process shortly, ahead of bringing forward separate draft regulations to make provision for transferring these cases. What we are covering today is our plans for adult disability payment and the detail of our processes for transferring the PIP awards of approximately 300,000 people safely and securely to adult disability payment, and our commitment to make sure that they are paid the right amount at the right time. But we also know that the considerations around the transfer from DLA to ADP is a really important process too. And as I said, we'll be bringing forward regulations shortly, and I will update the committee as soon as possible on that separately and following this session. Convener, thank you.
That's great. Thank you very much, Minister. I'm going to move now to my colleague Marie McNair, but before I do so, I do realise that we have quite a lot of themes and questions to still explore. So if I can get everybody to try and ask their questions succinctly and answer succinctly as well. I know I sound like the presiding officer there, but I am conscious of time, and we have a lot of questions to put to the Minister and his officials. So Marie, over to you, and then we'll bring Jeremy back in after that. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and I'll be quick. Minister, you've set out clear timescales for the transfer of PIP to ADP. And the history of DWP transfers appears to suggest that timescales are often frequently missed. For example, DLA to PIP and legacy benefits to Universal Credit. How confident are you that timescales you've set out will be met?
We are confident in the process for case transfer for child disability payment is operating well. Adult disability payment is a significant undertaking in that we initially will be looking at around 1,000 application transfers per, let me just make sure I get this absolutely right, per month. So estimating around 7,000 a month initially, and then we'll look to ramp that up as we get the system underway and begin more experience and confidence with the processes and making sure that everything is running properly for that safe and secure transfer. So we continue to be determined to transfer all benefits by 2025. And that's for the delivery of our case transfer for all benefits, and that's our aspiration, and particularly, of course, for adult disability.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. Mary, do you have anything further to ask or add?
No further questions, Convener. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that, Mary. And helpfully, Jeremy has indicated to me that Pam covered his question. So if we could move on to my colleague Faisal Chaudhry for the next theme three, he has some questions. So over to yourself, Faisal. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and welcome to the group and congratulations. I would also like to congratulate our colleague Neil on his new post. Can I ask what support will be given to young people who are transferring on ADP, and how will it be deployed?
Thank you. Thank you. I'll try and be as succinct as possible, Convener. We discussed these issues when I brought previous regulations to the committee on the 28th of October. And although CDP and ADP are both types of assistance, they are different types of assistance. And they are different because the eligibility criteria are different and reflect the difference in daily needs and support of adults and children. So for disabled children, their needs can change as they age and grow. And up to the age of 16, one of the deciding factors is what their needs are when compared with a child the same age who's not disabled. The criteria for adult disability payment alternatively and more complexly assesses the individual's ability to carry out the fine set of necessary daily living and mobility activities safely to acceptable standard repeatedly and within a reasonable time period. If we were to treat this process as a transfer from one form of disability assistance to another, the information held by Social Security Scotland in relation to a CDP award would likely not be sufficient to make a decision on entitlement to adult disability payment for many clients. So they would therefore need to provide further supporting information and potentially be then required to make an application to adult disability payment. It's therefore in the best interests for young people, for clients on child disability payment, to make an application to adult disability payment. Extensive support and advice will be available to young people and their families undergoing this process through a choice of channels. And we are committed to making this process as smooth as possible with no gap in payment to ensure that it will be less disruptive than the current system. And SCOS will welcome these changes, commenting that it is likely to strengthen the rights of clients undergoing this process. I've set out, I'll leave it there, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. Faisal, do you have any further questions on that issue?
Yes, I do. Yeah. Thank you, Minister, for the answer. In terms of the application process, will there be much difference for those who are and are not on CDP?
First of all, again, just setting out from a CDP perspective, the process of applying for adult disability payment has been designed to minimise gaps in the entitlement, as I said, to ensure that the process is as smooth as possible. And in contrast to the current system, young people will be given a significant flexibility in choosing when to apply for adult disability payment after their 16th birthday. Someone's child disability payment will only stop when a positive determination is made for adult disability payment. If they do not receive any award of adult disability payment, their child disability payment will continue until their 18th birthday. there will be that additional support. A range of measures will be put in place to ensure the process at this key transition point is as straightforward as possible. They will be able to access a single secure digital portal to apply for all forms of assistance, update information, check eligibility, and our local delivery service team will be there for in-person support. And young people will also be entitled to the support of our independent advocacy if they need help. Independent advocacy service, which of course we're committing £20 million to providing, if they need support applying for adult disability payments. So there will be considerations in place for those who are on child disability payment and in their applications for adult disability payment, as I've set out in the last two answers. And I hope that answers Mr. Faisal Chowdhury's questions.
Thank you very much, Minister. Faisal, do you have anything further to ask?
Yeah, just the last question, Convener, and thank you very much. The short-term assistance is available while someone challenges a decision to reduce or stop their benefit, and it's not available for someone applying for a different benefit. The Scottish Government had rejected the SCOSS recommendation. Can Minister explain more in detail about the decision?
So, first of all, members will be aware that short-term assistance is something that is only available in the Scottish Social Security system and isn't available in the DWP system. And, you know, just another one of the points that I need to emphasise is the fact that our system will be different and more supportive of people. So short-term assistance, as members will know, supports people in challenging a decision and accessing their rights under the Social Security Act 2018, addressing barriers to accessing justice through removing certain financial disincentives to challenging decisions that exist in the UK DWP system. However, and this is an important point in answer to Mr. Faisal Chowdhury's question, child disability payment and adult disability payment are separate forms of assistance with different eligibility criteria. And short-term assistance is not designed to be a bridge payment between two forms of assistance. And extending the scope of short-term assistance in this way would represent a significant departure from the current policy intent of short-term assistance in requiring it to be paid on the basis of an award an award a client would not longer be eligible for because of their age or because of them being receipt of adult disability payment. So continuing to pay a client's previous award during the redetermination relies on having on a client having a previous award for a particular form of assistance that has been reduced or stopped. So if short-term assistance were to be extended to cover this move between forms of assistance, it would be paid on the basis of a different payment relating to different eligibility criteria to cover a period where a client was challenging a decision on a separate form of assistance. So it's effectively short-term assistance is for the redetermination and appeals process, not as a bridging payment.
Thank you very much for that answer, Minister. I'm now going to bring my colleague Miles Briggs in, and after that will be my colleague Natalie Dawn, who will speak to theme three, but also move on to theme four. So over to yourself, Miles. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Congratulations on your appointment, Convener. And can I also pass on my thanks to Neil Gray? We all miss his colourful socks, I think, in committee when we're able to meet in person again. Good morning, Minister. And there's a few questions I wanted to carry on from the line of questioning Faisal Chowdhury had developed there. And specifically, I wondered what the Scottish Government's view was with regards to the merits around a single disability benefit that would apply for children, working age and older people.
Thank you for that. So the process of considerations around that, I presume the committee's interest in it is with regard to considerations around the Green Paper from the UK Government. We don't want to preempt the review. The necessary prioritisation of safe and secure delivery of adult disability payment means that we have been clear throughout this process about our intention that changes to eligibility criteria should not be made before case transfer process is complete, as I've stated many times today. The second stage of the independent review, which I've talked about earlier, will enable exploration of wider considerations around how we want a Scotland. And this will provide an opportunity to consider alternative approaches, such as a whole life disability benefit, without introducing a significant change to eligibility criteria, which would put safe and secure transfer at risk. So in order to do that, we need an agency capable of delivering change and adapting, and that's why it's therefore important in building the capacity of Social Security Scotland that we undertake the period ahead in a safe and secure way. But you know, we want to hear what the independent review says, and I think the point that Mr. Briggs raises, of course, will be a point of interest in that review process.
Thanks, Minister. Back to you, Miles.
Thank you for that answer, and it would be useful to update the committee on any timelines the government are aware of with that independent review, because I think we're quite keen to add value to that where we can as well. I wanted to ask, in terms of some of the changes which I think have been announced today by DWP with regards to PIP application processes, to actually try to make it easier for people to start a new claim. Have the Scottish Government captured and been involved in that work? And as we see these changes going forward, specifically for individuals who need assistance to make a claim, people who will not necessarily be the individual making a phone call, for example, but supporting someone, will that be captured in any changes to the ADP system? And is that something the Minister's aware of? So we actually see a system which can be flexible both at a UK level and in Scotland.
Please excuse me, I'm not aware of the changes that have been announced today, which maybe says something more about the UK government's approach to intergovernmental relations than anything else. I will look forward to examining them with interest. I mean, I think I would say that our system, in terms of its accessibility, both the fact that people will be able to apply in a way that suits them both best, whether that's online, whether that's in person through our local delivery teams, whether that's on the phone, whether that's through video calls, all of these aspects in terms of the accessibility of our system will make a difference. The fact that people will be able to apply online will be significantly improved, and the process of going through an online application, we have designed the interface in a way that will be much more helpful for people in order to make sure that we get accurate results in terms of the findings that are decided at the end of the process, but also the experience for people. And of course, yeah, there will be support in Scotland, both through the local delivery teams and through the independent advocacy service that are not available elsewhere in the UK. Grateful for Mr. Briggs for raising the points that he is aware of in terms of DWP announcements. I look forward to examining them and perhaps dealing with Mr. Briggs and the committee on them further in due course.
Thank you, Minister. Miles, do you have further questions?
Just finally, thank you for that. And I think it's an important area we should develop and some of the work going on, specifically returning to younger people, though, because I think it's important we really do see a system which can meet their needs. How do you think, Minister, the system has been designed to really consider younger people and how they may not be encouraged, may not be aware of what benefits are available, and how will we see that change compared to what's gone previously?
Well, I think the introduction of child disability payment, which is already in place, is a significant improvement and change that has been undertaken. And as I talked about earlier, as younger people in the child disability payment system reach the age of 16, in that period between the age of 16 and 18, there will be significant improved support and awareness of how they go through the process of applying for adult disability payment. Janet Richardson in a moment to talk about from an agency side, but the way that we as a government, of course, are promoting our benefits more widely, all the discussions we've had collectively with yourselves on committee and more generally as a parliament on the importance of the benefits take up strategy, the importance of utilising all communications and networks to raise awareness of what social security support is available. We are in a healthy place on that, but there is always more that we can do to raise awareness in communities of what is available. And of course, when adult disability payment is launched, if Parliament chooses to pass these regulations, which I really hope they do, that will be again an opportunity for all of us in every constituency, in every region, to promote these new benefits and to encourage people support if they need it and if they're entitled to it, because we want them to get.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. Miles, is that you?
Yeah, happy to hand back to yourself, convener, if interested in time.
That's great. Thanks very much. I'm now going to move.
I said that I would bring Janet in, but perhaps.
Oh, sorry. On you go. Yeah. No, if you want to bring Janet in, on you come in, Janet. Thanks.
Thank you, convener. Thank you, Minister. I'll be brief on this because, Minister, I think you covered quite a lot of it there in terms of the support for young people. Absolutely, we're working closely with Young Scotland. So our local delivery teams are obviously out and about in our local communities and reaching out to stakeholders who are supporting young people as well. Obviously, we've had quite extensive feedback so far from the way that we are interacting with people for child disability payment, and we're obviously linking that into how we'll take that forward into adult as well. There's a lot of learning going on just at the moment. The other thing that we've done, obviously, in that young people space, which is primarily for the child disability payment at the moment, but will come into force for adult as well, is that we've recruited practitioners who are specialists in children's health and wellbeing issues. So we've proactively recruited people into that space as well to support young people going forward. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that, Janet.
Just briefly, convener, I would just also state that I noted Bill Scott's evidence to the committee on December and his positive comments around the difference that the local delivery teams have made in the delivery of child disability payment, and also his important points around how word of mouth around the different experience and the better service has been quite significant when it comes to child disability payment. And I'm confident that when we deliver adult disability payment that we will see a similar effect of people really having a different and improved experience in that, helping to build confidence in the communities and in the new service that we're providing.
Thank you very much for those additional comments, Minister. They were very helpful. I'm going to move on to my colleague Natalie Dawn, who has some questions on this theme and also theme 4, and then we'll bring Evelyn Tweed in to speak to theme 5. Natalie, over to yourself. Thank you.
Thanks, convener. We've touched on a couple of the points that I was going to raise, but I'm just going to seek a little bit more clarification and on theme 3, and then I'll move on to theme 4. I think it's really, really positive, the flexibility that we're given to 16-year-olds in terms of applying between 16 and 18. And I'm just wondering if you can give me a little bit more information on the sentiments and the reasoning that we've chosen to do so. We also touched on the local delivery services a second ago, and I just want to elaborate a little bit more. I think from the information you've given, do you feel that they're going to have a strong role within helping people transfer from child disability payment to ADP?
Thank you. Yes, I mean, I think the feedback from Bill Scott on this point to the committee on the 16th of December was powerful, and feedback on the difference that the local delivery teams have made with regard to the delivery of CDP and helping people undertake those applications. And of course, that will be the same for adult disability payment. The pandemic and the restrictions have had an impact, of course, in, for example, local delivery teams carrying out face-to-face assistance, whether that be in community settings or in people's homes. However, as restrictions ease, those aspects will gain even more prominence. But the local delivery teams, the fact that they are in all 32 local authorities and making impact and helping people apply, I think is a significant improvement with regard to the Scottish Social Security system and is making a positive difference in communities. In terms of the importance that we've given to people transferring from child disability to adult disability payment, we have prioritised the awards of clients who are between 15.5 and 18 to ensure that they will be receiving child disability payment and can be supported by Social Security Scotland when it's time for them to transition to adult disability payment. This also minimises the need for those who require an appointee upon turning 16 to have to go through two different appointee processes, one with DWP and then another with us once their awards is transferred. So we decided to prioritise those who meet the special rules for terminal illness as well to make sure they can avail themselves of our more generous eligibility rules as soon as possible. So we're still working with DWP to determine how we will prioritise the awards of clients who are under 15.5, but we'll do so in a way that best minimises the biggest impacts that those staying with the DWP system may face. That's helpful in answering Ms Dawn's questions.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. Natalie. Sorry, Convener.
I was just thank you, Minister. Yeah, as I say, I think it's positive, the flexibility. I think it shows that we're really taking a person-centred approach to this. I will move on to theme four, and again, we've sort of touched on some of this, but I just want a little bit more clarity. Can you give us a general update on the recruitment of the 2,000 additional staff, how that's progressing, and specifically how it's progressing in relation to the case managers and the specialist practitioners? I know that was mentioned in the letter that you sent. I'd also like to ask again, we've touched on some of the training and how we are taking people on in terms of how people are going to deal with those applying for disability benefits. We've all heard sort of horror stories of how people have been treated by DWP, etc. So how will you ensure with this, the most complex of benefits where people really need support, they need respect, how will you ensure that this will be adhered to at all times?
Such important questions, and I'll bring Janet Richardson in shortly, but just briefly and firstly for myself. So I hope the letter that I sent yesterday was reassuring and of interest to the committee. We are on track with the recruitment of case managers and practitioners. We have created case managers, practitioners and senior practitioners with backgrounds in social care, social work, nursing, learning disability, mental health and general health, physiotherapy and occupational therapy. And the skill set spanning across these backgrounds is vast. They include cancer, kidney disease, neurodiversity, long-term mental health, adults with problematic alcohol or substance abuse, arthritis, eating disorders. And our recruitment has been focused on senior practitioners, ensuring there is experience of leading teams of health and social care professionals when we've been recruiting senior practitioners. We facilitate monthly information sessions internally in Social Security Scotland, and inviting those interested in our vacancies to come to an information session to learn more about our job roles. And again, that's encouraging further recruitment. In terms of training, everyone delivering disability assistance, including practitioners, will undergo robust training reflective of the core values of dignity, fairness and respect. And this will include training on the impact of common health conditions. Wherever possible, that training will be developed in consultation with and delivered in conjunction with people with lived experience of health conditions and disabilities. Training will be ongoing, and Social Security Scotland will continue to look for ways to add to training for staff and work with organisations in order to provide that. And that's to make sure that we continue to get that insight from stakeholders, particularly around conditions where it's important that there's an awareness within the agency and those making decisions of the subtleties and complexities and nuances of certain conditions. Specific training and guidance will also be provided to practitioners and case managers on the special rules of for terminal illness. So I could say a lot more, but I'll leave it there in the interest of time. But I would be grateful if Janet could come in briefly with any points that I haven't made yet. And of course, Janet also referred to the fact that we've recruited people with expertise in working with young people. So she's already made that point as well. Over to you, Janet.
Thank you, Dina. Thank you. And yes, just really to re-emphasise some of the points there, that I think the question was really around sort of how can we make sure that people have those skills that we need when they're looking at some of the complex kinds of disabilities population. So what we've tried to do, what we are doing, is using a very much a scenario-based approach and using case studies within our training. So the case managers are working alongside our practitioners with cases that we have put together from liaising with clients themselves and also from stakeholders, so real life cases, obviously anonymised, but to help us understand what the impact of some of those conditions are, to make sure the case managers and the practitioners work really closely together on that. And in terms of the recruitment, you know, we already have people in place now for adult disability for the pilot, so that training is already ongoing. It takes somewhere around 2 months to get our case managers up to speed, and they then have quite a lengthy period of consolidation before they actually go into that live working environment. So our recruitment's been really successful in terms of case managers, and I think we are welcoming something around 800 different colleagues, not just as case managers, into the agency between the start of the year and the end of March. So absolutely, our recruitment processes are working, which is good. Just in addition to the, if you like, the technical training that we give to our case managers, I think it's important to say that they all go through what we call intelligent kindness and trauma-informed approach. So it's not just about how they assess the information that the client gives, which is absolutely important, but it is about how they deal with clients and how they make them feel. And that, you know, that main thing is we trust the information that comes from the client in the main, and that we are not always looking for additional information there. And then just briefly on the practitioners. So again, the recruitment for that is well underway. We are expecting that we will need round about 300 practitioners when we get fully into adult disability payment. That is a ballpark figure. It's not something that we are aiming to definitely get to, but that's what we think we will need. We do have around 30 practitioners in place just now. And again, they are going through that really comprehensive training, which we talked about earlier. So it's not just about the experience they already have, it's about how we will need them to help us get to the right decision for the clients, working closely with the case manager.
Thanks very much for that, Janet. That's very helpful. Minister, anything further to add? I know that Natalie would like to come back in with a further question.
I would just say thank you, Convener, over and above just what Janet laid out. You will note in the letter that I sent to you yesterday that there are also confirmed start dates for 37 candidates, 20 practitioners and 17 senior practitioners between now and April. So as well as the 29 that Janet mentioned, there is what I've just said here.
Thank you very much for that additional information. Natalie, back to yourself for your question.
Thank you. The answers are very informative, so I appreciate that. Thank you. This is just more of a general question. it kind of follows an issue that I raised last week at last week's meeting as well. So obviously the legislation is as always full of jargon, and it's not very easy to read. So I'm just wanting confirmation from the Minister that there will be guidance and eligibility criteria that will be simple and easy for people to understand. Obviously this relates to CDP and DDP.
Absolutely. In our communications with stakeholders and applicants, there will be significant understandable but also accessible correspondence available. Janet, I don't know if you want to add anything further to that.
No, Minister, Janet. I think you've covered it there. Thank you. No, I don't think I have anything further to add to that point.
Just a short one, just looking for confirmation. Thank you. Thanks, back to you.
That's great. Thank you very much for that, Natalie. I'm going to bring my colleague Evelyn Tweed in, who will speak to both theme 5 and 6, and then after that, Jeremy Balfour will come back in as well to speak to theme 6. So, Evelyn, over to you. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener, and congratulations on your new post. And I would like to wish Neil Gray all the best as a minister. I'm sure he'll be absolutely great. I am very, very excited about ADP, and it's been a long road since 2018. I think the Scottish Government has done an absolute power of work, and as we've heard from people with lived experience, this is going to be an absolute game changer for them. And my first question is around the financial impact of the changes. And to the Minister, how do you square the two areas of keeping an eye on rising costs that need paid for, alongside the duty to encourage take up and promoting this benefit?
I think some really important points, and thanks to Evelyn Tweed for her important words around the significant moment that we're at this point with the launch of adult disability payment. I think just on the question around how do we keep an eye on the rising costs that they paid for alongside the duty to encourage take up and promoting this and other benefits. Myself and Bill Ministers are absolutely clear that Social Security is a human right, and therefore we are committed to ensuring that everyone who is entitled to support in our system is able to receive it. Our take-up strategies detail how we will encourage and support people to overcome barriers to accessing support, and of course we have a duty to promote take-up regardless of how much is being spent on adult disability payment, and that is a duty to promote take-up that is in the 2018 Act. Indeed, many of the improvements we are making to the application decision-making process are intended to remove barriers to applying for disability benefits that currently exist in the system. So we will be promoting, we will be making it more accessible, we will be making it more straightforward, and we will be helping people in their journey through our advocacy service and through our local delivery team. So it's a real shift in consciousness from the approach from the Department of Work and Pensions and some of the experiences people have had in terms of the fact that claiming benefits has attracted this completely unjust and unethical stigma that we all need to now knock away. We want to remove stigma, we want to promote take up, and we want to encourage people to get the support they need, because a social security system that is there to support people and is accessible and delivering is good not just for the person receiving the awards and that they're entitled to, but it's also good for wider society as a whole as we create a fairer society together, and also in terms of distribution in the economy and the fiscal impact that that can have, and multiplier effect that that can have on the economy. But that's not the most important thing. The most important thing is that people get the support they're entitled to, and we're very committed, and I hope you feel that from what I've said, to encouraging people and helping people to get that support.
Evelyn? Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Minister. I absolutely do. There is a range of new support available to people applying for disability benefits, including short-term assistance and the advocacy service. What are the costs of those, and do you think that this is a good use of resources to come from the Scottish Government budget?
Yes, absolutely. They are a good use of resources because they will be there to help people throughout their journey, and there was strong demand in the process of the 2018 Act, the bill going through the Parliament in 2016-17, and then the passing of the 2018 Act for those initiatives to be introduced. They're an investment in the people of Scotland, and they are a result of it. Extensive consultation with people with experience of the social security system now, and disabled people's organisations and experts. So I'm confident that these changes will result in a significantly better experience for people applying for and receiving adult disability payment, reflective again of my point I made earlier, which is I think it's hugely important that social security is a human right, and we want to deliver it within the principles that we're committed to of dignity, fairness and.
Thanks, Minister. Evelyn? Thank you, Convener. And why have you chosen the same council areas for the pilot as CDP? And what lessons have been learnt from the rollout of CDP.
Thank you. So we have selected the areas for the first pilot similar to child disability payment because they represent a mixture of urban and rural geography. And using the same local authorities for phase one of the pilot for adult disability payment enables us to build on the working relationships and constructive engagement we've had with Perth and Kinross, Dundee City and Western Isles local authorities. And I should just say, put on the record today that we are incredibly grateful for all the engagement that we have with local authorities, health boards and others on the delivery of adult disability payment and all of our benefits. And then after that phase one, of course, adult disability payment will include significantly more local authority areas through the pilot phases. That will we've created the programme in a way that considers both geographical spread and also builds into our commitment to delivering things in a safe and secure way and making sure that we continue to build up the system up so that when full rollout happens at the end of August, we've undertaken a significant amount of local authorities being engaged in the system already and we're in a strong position to deliver the service nationally.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. Evelyn, is that you finished or do you have?
Yes, that's me, Convener. Thank you.
That's great. Can we move on now to a question from Jeremy Balfour on this topic?
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, just a fairly brief question, Minister. You have outlined previously that there will be a track review for this and the first one will start later this year. When would you expect that first track in regard to the mobility issue to report to you, Scottish Government? Are you going to set them a timetable and can you outline that for today?
So just back on the review of adult disability payment, just for
clarity. Yes.
I'm happy to come back to the committee at a future juncture, I should say, to talk about the review more generally, and I think it'd be helpful. Certainly keen to give that undertaking today. As I said in a previous answer, the planning and scoping work is already underway for the first stage of the review, and I will provide a further update as soon as possible in due course to both the committee and
Parliament. It would be helpful just to know when we think this review will, how long the review will take, and when that will report back to you and to the Parliament. So, thank you. No further questions, Convener.
Thank you very much for your question, Jeremy, and your answer. Minister, sorry if everybody can hear, there's a dog barking outside the door. I don't know if that's translating through blue jeans or not. Do we have any other further members who wish to come in at this juncture? Not seeing any indications. If it's okay, I myself will put a question to Minister. For me, it's clear that these regulations will herald a new benefit for disabled adults, which is, of course, a major change in social security in Scotland, whilst also seeing a change in how people will be treated, which is, you know, as somebody who has personal and professional experience of the benefit systems is really important. Can I ask you, Minister, to round up this session by explaining to the committee how you will measure success or failure of this benefit and vitally how you're going to ensure that disabled people and receipt of the benefits themselves will be involved in that valuation? Because I think that's really important. Thank you.
Thank you. So, first of all, I think it is such a significant moment in terms of the fact that we're delivering in a way that will be as straightforward as possible, that we will always start from a position of trust, that people will be able to choose how they apply in the channel that best meets their needs, that we'll be funding the independent advocacy service, that there'll be no DWP assessments, and there won't be functional DWP style assessments, rather, and there won't be any functional examinations. And the fact that we will only need to collect one piece of supporting information when making a decision, formal piece of information, and that the onus to collect that will be on Social Security Scotland to do so on people's behalf. It will be giving equal consideration to all sources of information, including clients, family, carers, friends, and that we will, importantly, as has been emphasised throughout our discussion, that we will apply the eligibility criteria fairly and consistently to get more decisions right first time, that we will take full account of people's needs and fluctuating conditions, and that people challenging an adult disability decision will be able to access short-term assistance when challenging a decision, and of course that we will fast-track applications from people with a terminal illness. So there's so much that we're doing that I think we should be positive about collectively, and of course, as we've discussed today, we will, as the process of the delivery of adult disability payment combined with the case transfer process, as that progresses, we will also think collectively through the review and through our discussion what constructive changes we can make going forward over and above these significant improvements. In terms of the evaluation, the evaluation programme will provide assessments on the operation of key aspects of the delivery of the new benefits. These include new procedures applicable to adult disability payment as they unfold, including the provision of supporting information, special rules for terminal illness, client consultations, the case transfer from UK benefits, and decision-making processes. The first of these thematic evaluations is an assessment of the operation of provision of supporting information for benefit decisions, drawing on the experience of child disability payment, which will be commissioned later this year, and further aspects of evaluation that might require more evidence from adult disability payment in particular, such as consultations, terminal illness rules and award duration, require the caseload to build up over time and the consequences to be emerging, and we'll of course be considerate of that. And you know, I think the engagement with stakeholders is so important and has been up to this point. So we invite academic and third sector organisations to our annual Social Security Evaluation Forum to discuss our approaches to evaluating benefits. And we will continue to engage with our stakeholders appropriately and meaningfully. And of course, as I've said, throughout the process of our considerations today, we deeply value the input of our stakeholders, and not just in considering these regulations before us, but through the whole process of establishing our new social security system in Scotland, which is and will continue to make a significant and meaningful difference for people in our communities all across the country.
Thank you, Minister, for those words. I do understand that my colleague Miles Briggs has a further two questions to come in before we move to the formal debate on the motion. So, Miles, over to yourself.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I just had two questions. One on the back of the letter which you'd sent to committee yesterday with regards to recruitment around practitioners. We've discussed this previously, Minister, with regards to the development of hubs and where people will actually be located to work. And I just wondered if you could update the committee on that and some of the discussions I'd had with yourself previously with regards to local authorities and potential to create hubs where people could go access these individuals, or for them to be actually helping people in their homes as we see lifting of pandemic regulations around that. So I just wondered where the government were on that development of potential hubs for these practitioners.
So just for clarity, I'm presuming that Mr. Briggs is talking about local delivery teams, which are of course active now, and they are operating in community hubs and undertaking, with consideration to the restrictions around the pandemic, of course, in recent weeks and months, but have been undertaking face-to-face assistance rather, with clients already for CDP and stand ready to do that for ADP. So, I'm going to bring Janet Richardson in a moment from the agency perspective, but yes, I just would emphasise that that service is up and running already in terms of our local delivery team. Janet, could you elaborate further, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister. And yes, thank you for the question. I think this is around the practitioners themselves rather than the local delivery teams. In terms of the Scottish Government's view on hubs, I can't comment on that, but what I can tell you is what we are looking to do for the practitioners. As we've said all along, we don't necessarily envisage a large proportion of our clients needing a face-to-face interaction with practitioners. If they choose to do that, or we feel it's necessary, then we can offer that. But by and large, we feel they will be there as an advisory capacity. But they will be within that local vicinity. And the Minister has already talked about our local delivery teams are based in hubs and offices within all local authorities. So what we are looking at is whether there are opportunities for practitioners to be in those premises as well. It might not always be appropriate, but absolutely, you know, that is something we can do. So if a face-to-face is needed, we will look at that. We are also looking at if it's necessary, that could be done in the client's home if that is their choice. But as I said, we do think that those appointments in that way will be few and far between compared to the current process. Thank you.
That's helpful. Thanks very much. I think last time we discussed this, it wasn't necessarily clear if they would be located within the hub. So I welcome any additional information you could maybe provide us with as and when that develops. And just finally, I wanted to ask with regards to financial projections, the information the committee had been given, and specifically some of the work which Scottish Fiscal Commission have been doing around updating potential spend around ADP, suggested by 2026 we would see a rise to £567 million. This new budget looks towards £38 million. So I just wondered if there's any updated figures, given we'll be debating the budget this afternoon for stage one, Minister, and where the current financial projections currently stand.
Minister.
Thank you. Thank you. So the financial projections, as the Scottish Fiscal Commission recently published, are the projections rather that we are currently considering collectively. As I mentioned earlier, our commitment to Social Security as a human right and our commitment to the benefits we're delivering will mean, of course, that through the forthcoming resource spending review, we will be considering funding and spending forecasts more generally as we continue to deliver plans in terms of targeted public spending to where it delivers the greatest benefit. And of course, our commitment to Social Security delivery is a key part of that. You know, it's as I stated in an earlier answer, our commitment to delivering, of course, to the people who are entitled to benefits is absolutely clear, and the finances will be made available in order to make sure that we meet that commitment to people. That is absolutely clear. What I would also add, and I say this as a statement of fact and regret, is of course there is a significant amount of resource that the Scottish Government has to spend directly mitigating the impact of UK government policies, particularly through discretionary housing payments, but also through the Scottish Welfare Fund. And of course, that totaled £114 million in the financial year 2021-22. So I just say that as a reflective point of it would be much better if we could spend that resource elsewhere rather than having to mitigate bad policy decisions in the UK.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. Miles, do you have anything further?
Thank you, Kavina. No, I'll try not to get into a debate over policy decisions by the Scottish Government at this late stage in the committee meeting. So I hand back to you. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't have any further indications of anybody wishing to speak at this point, so we will move on to agenda item 4, which is the formal debate on the motion. And I do remind committee that only members and the Minister may take part in the formal debate. I invite the Minister to move motion S6M-02604. That the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Disability Assistance for Working Age People Scotland Regulations 2022 be approved. Minister?
Formally moved.
Thank you. Do any members wish to speak in the debate on the motion? Please type R in the chat box if you want to come in. Oh, and my doorbell goes. What, would you believe that? That's just, what can you do when this happens? And you're live to everybody that's watching. I do have three people who have indicated that they would like to speak, so I'm going to bring Pam Duncan-Glancy in first, then Evelyn Tweed, and then Jeremy Balfour. So Pam Duncan-Glancy, please, it's over to you.
Thank you, convener. Too many disabled people are in poverty. Thousands have spent blood, sweat and tears trying to get the support they need to live their life, only to be told that they don't qualify for that or that support is being cut. The regulations here today could have changed that. We could have consigned to history degrading and arbitrary measures like the 20-metre and 50% rules. We could have developed indicators that reflect the real experience of disabled people and the support they need. And we could have been voting on rates of payment that reflect the real cost of living for disabled people. But, convener, minister, we are not, and I cannot mask my disappointment. None of the regulations in front of us change who is eligible or for how much. They don't address problems with the descriptors. They replicate the PIP rules. Most disappointingly of all, they miss the opportunity that we have to recast the rules on something that could properly have addressed disabled people's poverty. In 2017, in response to Scottish Labour's ask for assurances that the new system would be ambitious and would not have the same effects as the PIP rules, the then Cabinet Secretary replied that the Scottish Government does not intend to replicate the UK Government legislation in our social security, as will be clear from our actions. 5 years later, we are asked to vote for underwhelming rules and trust that something better is coming again. Disabled people have already waited years on a promise that these regulations do not deliver. Every day they wait is a day we all lose out on their potential because poverty holds people back. And so, despite our disappointment, because of the need to not delay this further, Scottish Labour will vote for the regulations today. But I'd like the record to show that we are voting for the regulations because disabled people have waited long enough, and so they must proceed. Because we believe that the current PIP system is so appalling that we will not block an attempt, however unimaginative or unambitious, to improve it. And because we will make sure that the promises this government made to disabled people in 2017 will not be broken or delayed a minute longer.
Thank you very much for that, Pam. Evelyn Tweed, please.
Thank you, convener. As I said in my earlier remarks, I am very excited about the introduction of ADP. The Scottish Government has done a power of work in preparation for this, and we have heard from stakeholders and from those with lived experience that this is to be welcomed. And I very much hope that we will achieve cross-party support today for ADP. Thanks, convener.
Thank you very much for that, Evelyn. And over to yourself, Jeremy Balfour, and then Marie McNair.
Thank you, convener. As someone who has walked this journey for 5 years, I will be voting for amendments, but I will be voting with them with a heavy heart. Unlike Evelyn Tweed, I see no excitement in these regulations today. And interesting, both members of this committee who are actually on PIP and who have disabilities are voting with them with a heavy heart. And perhaps that says a lot about where we are today. The disability community are accepting this because there is nothing else on offer. This is not what we were offered by Scottish Government 5 years ago. I and Ben McPherson, our Minister, sat on this committee. We heard from Cabinet Secretaries, we heard from civil servants, we heard from stakeholders that we wanted a system that was radically different from what we are having today. We are not addressing fundamental issues such as mobility. We are not addressing people who have variable conditions such as MS, epilepsy, who are still not going to get an award. They may be told no in a nicer way, but they're still going to be said no. This is a lost opportunity for this Parliament and for this country. We started 5 years ago with a blank piece of paper, an opportunity to design something that would have helped those with disability get the benefits that we need and deserved. In fact, that's what we were promised by the Scottish Government. And all we have done today is paste across what we have had for many years. So I do hope that the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister, Mr McPherson, will hear what disabled people are saying, maybe not in public at committees, but saying in private about these regulations. We have taken 5 years to get to this point. I don't blame particularly the new agency. I do think Scottish Government have dragged this process out and have taken far too long. So I will vote for them because there's nothing else on offer and we do not want to delay what has happened. But I do so with no excitement, with a heavy heart. And I do hope that any review will be quick and speedy and will implement the changes that people in Scotland with disability deserve. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much for your contribution, Jeremy. And I'll now move to Marie McNairs for hers. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I don't agree with Mr Balfour's comments there, but I think these regulations are a key point in the biggest transfer of social security powers in our nation's history, and they're key to giving disabled people the dignity and respect that have been long denied by the Westminster system. The approach set out makes a safe and secure transport fare a priority, and this is how it should be, and that's what the consultation has asked for. It allows us to make changes, a more compassionate, generous approach to claimants with terminal illness, the introduction of short-term assistance not provided in any other part of the UK, and this is recognition of the financial hardship experienced in real life by many of our constituents, more time to challenge decisions and assistance to get the best possible information to aid decisions, and add an ending to the use of the private sector assessments that cause great misery to disabled people claiming what they're due. So these are just a few examples of what we've achieved in a short term, and an independent review help us guide us to further important change. So I just think we should just agree the recommendations, because they take a massive step forward to provide a social security system that's been long overdue. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Marie, for your comments. And before I hand back to the Minister for his right to reply and winding up, I would just like to state, as a disabled adult and somebody who has self-excluded from the benefits process due to being somebody who has represented people at tribunals in my professional life, I do believe that these regulations as set out would speak to those people who like me, have self-excluded and perhaps will see them applying to Social Security Scotland for adult disability payment. So, Minister, can I come back to yourself for a right of reply before we move to the vote on the motion?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to all members for their summing up remarks. I think, you know, I listen attentively to and with respect and good faith to all of the points that have been made, and I'm grateful for and very much welcome the cross-party support. I appreciate the points that have been made by the opposition parties. And I acknowledge their determination to see further change in the way that they wish to see it. And as I respect that, I would ask them to respect this as well. We are in a situation right now where we are in a hybrid system, and we are in a situation where we are under two very important work streams of launching a new benefit and undertaking case transfer. And in that process, we have to make sure that we do not create a two-tier system. We have to make sure that we undertake safe and secure delivery. And we have to make sure that we have passporting agreements in place with the Department of Work. And just as I asked them to respect that reality of the situation in the here and now, I also ask that I appreciate their wish to see further change, but I think there should be acknowledgement also of the changes that have been made. The changes that have been made, and to make sure that we apply the right reliability criteria in a consistent and proper way in each case. The changes that are being made to make sure that the application process is more accessible and is a better experience for people. The changes that we've made around terminal illness, changes that we've made around the assessment process in terms of there being no private sector involvement, there being no DWP-style assessments, there being no functional examinations. and the other changes that I've laid out in the course of today's session. This is a really important moment in the development of devolution, in the delivery of our new social security system. And I think together, by passing these regulations, we are taking an important step collectively for the benefit of all of our constituents, and also in creating a system that is strong, robust, compassionate, and organised and structured in order to deliver for people in our communities in the years ahead, but also with a strong foundation for further delivery in the years and decades to come. So I am grateful for colleagues for indicating their support for the regulations, and I look forward to working with them as we progress into the next phase of delivering adult disability payment and continuing to build our social security system here in Scotland. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. And that now concludes the debate, and I'll now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M-02604 be approved. Are we all agreed? Yep, we are all agreed. Thank you. The motion is therefore approved. I invite the committee to agree that the clerks and I will produce a short factual report of the committee's decision and arrange to have it published as soon as possible. Have we agreed on that? Yep. Thank you very much. We're now going to move on to agenda item number 5, which is subordinate legislation. And we'll now move on to the debate on the motion for the information sharing regulations already discussed. I now invite the Minister to move the motion, S6M-02603, that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Social Security Information Sharing Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022 be approved. Minister?
Formally moved. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much. Do any members wish to speak in the debate on the motion? Please type R in the chat at the box if you wish to come in. I'll give it just a wee moment. I'm not seeing anybody want to come in. Minister, do you feel you need to wind up on this at all or speak to it?
In the interest of time, I'll wish to proceed to the voting process.
Okay, great. I will now put the question on the motion. The question is that the motion S6M-02603 be approved. Are we all agreed? Yep, I'm seeing everybody's agreed. Thank you very much. The motion is therefore approved. I invite the committee again to agree that the clerks and I will include consideration of this instrument for a short factual report. Is that agreed? Thank you very much. Thank you, Minister, for attending today with your officials. We're now going to consider agenda item number 6, which will consider a negative SSI. Members are invited to consider the Social Security period for redetermination requests, miscellaneous amendments, Scotland Regulations 2021. Backgrounds of these regulations are outlined in paper 4. Do members have any comments that they would like to raise in relation to these regulations? Could you please put an R in the chat to indicate? I'm not seeing any indication, so are members therefore content to note the instrument? Yep, that's great. Thank you very much. So that does conclude this morning's meeting. At our next meeting on the 3rd of February, we will be taking evidence on refugees and asylum as part of our work to explore the breadth of the committee's remit and establish key priorities for this session. And I look forward to that. And I now close this meeting. Thank you.